from my physical sight.
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidil Mursaleen. Amma ba'd, fa'a'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. As-salatu was-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah, as-salatu was-salamu alayka ya Habiballah, as-salatu was-salamu alayka ya Nabiyallah, wa ala alika wa ashabika ya Nurallah. Our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that a person who sends one time durood or salutations or salawat upon me, Allah azza wa jal sends 10 mercies upon him. Sallu ala al-habib sallallahu ta'ala ala Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Salatan wa salaman alayka ya Sayyidi ya Rasulallah wa ala alika wa ashabika ya Habiballah. Dearest Islamic brothers and the viewers of Madani channel, Alhamdulillah Azza wa Jal, once again we are blessed with this wonderful opportunity to participate in this silsila or program of Madani channel, Blessings of Hadith. As usual, inshallah Azza wa Jal, we will discuss few blessed ahadith of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and we'll try to understand them. أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من هومان لا يشبعان من هوم في العلم لا يشبع منه ومن هوم في الدنيا لا يشبع منها رواه البيهقي. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم has said in this hadith مباركة that two greedy people are never satisfied. One of them is the greedy of knowledge, and he is never fulfilled with knowledge. He always wants more. And the greedy of dunya or the world is never fulfilled with it. This hadith is reported by Imam Baihaqi. Greed or hirs means to have desire to have more. Worldly greed is bad, and deeni greed or greed towards deeni matters like ibadat or knowledge is good. An alim-e-deen is never fulfilled with the knowledge, because this is the ni'mat, the bounty of Almighty Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran Kareem, قُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. Say, O beloved, that, O my Lord, increase my knowledge. A worldly person is never fulfilled with the luxuries of dunya. He always wants more. And a deeni person, a true alim-e-deen, is never fulfilled with ibadat and with knowledge. He always wants to do more and learn more. Also keep in mind that everyone does for their own selves, but Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam does everything for the ummah. We are not fulfilled by taking from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That means we always want more from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is never fulfilled by giving his ummah. He always gives. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran Kareem, Harisun alaykum. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam desires the most your well-being and your welfare. The word is one, but it has several meanings. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is called Haris, Harisun alaykum, it has a different meaning. When an alim-e-deen is called Haris, it has a different meaning. And when a worldly person, a lover of dunya, is called Haris or greedy, it has a different meaning. Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi has said in his Chahal Hadith, in his 40 Hadith compilation, that this Hadith is narrated from many chains. All those chains are weak, but because the chains are in abundance, they are too many. And because many great ulama and scholars of Hadith have accepted this Hadith, therefore it is no more weak, it becomes a qawi, a strong Hadith. And it is an accepted rule of scholars of Hadith that when a da'if, a weak Hadith is narrated by many chains, it becomes hasan. We learned a wonderful principle here, that when a Hadith-e-Mubarakah is quoted by many scholars in their works, in different books, that means they trust that Hadith, even though according to the standards of scrutiny in the art of Hadith or in the science of Hadith, it is weak, but because of many scholars taking that Hadith and giving a reference of a particular Hadith, it becomes strong. So therefore, a Hadith like أَوَّلُ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ نُورِي, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that the first thing which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created is my light. So if there is any issue on the narration or on the sanad or on the chain, then because many, many great ulama and scholars have brought this Hadith and discussed this Hadith in their works and in their books, therefore that Hadith is no more weak, it actually becomes qawi, it becomes strong. وَعَنِ الْأَعْمَشِ قَالَ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ آفَةُ الْعِلْمِ النِّسْيَانُ وَإِدَاعَتُهُ أَن تُحَدِّثَ بِهِ غَيْرَ أَهْلِهِ رَوَاهُ الدَّارِمِيُّ مُرْسَلًا. This Hadith is reported from Hazrat A'mash radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He says that our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that the disaster of knowledge is to forget the knowledge. And the destruction of the knowledge is to explain or teach or give knowledge to an incapable person. This Hadith is reported in Darimi as a Mursal Hadith. As wealth and health get destroyed by many calamities with many reasons, similarly, ilm, knowledge, is destroyed by forgetting the knowledge. Therefore, ulama should always stay in touch with the books, with the knowledge. Studying, reading should continue. They must never put an end to research. Then the knowledge will stay. And if they get involved in other matters and they have no time and they have got no touch with the knowledge, with the books, even though they are qualified and they could be very clever in their work, but because of keeping no touch with the knowledge, they'll forget many things and they would not be able to give proper guidance. And that is actually a disaster for the knowledge. And also, they must try to avoid those things which weakens the memory. Allama Shami rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi has said that six things make the memory weak. Number one, to eat or drink something which is touched by the mouth of a rat. Number two, to catch a lice and then leave it alive. That means when you catch a lice, you must kill it. Number three, to urinate in standing water. And number four, to chew the gum, which is known as alak goond, that comes from a tree. To chew that or to eat that, that weakens the memory. To eat a sour apple, that weakens the memory. And to eat the peels of apple, that also weakens the memory. So these are six reasons mentioned by Allama Shami rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. So if anyone has habit of using any of those things and eating any of those things, they should avoid that. And there's a beautiful wazifa that someone can do to make their memory strong. That after every namaz, put your right hand on your head and read 21 times, Ya Qaviyyo, Ya Qaviyyo, Ya Qaviyyo. Inshallah Azza wa Jal, your memory will become strong. And then it is mentioned in this Hadith Mubarakah that destruction of knowledge is to discuss it or express it to the incapable people. What it means? It means that those people who are unable to understand the finer points and the details and the insight of the knowledge. So if these people are taught knowledge, because they will not have full and thorough understanding of knowledge, therefore they will go in the world and due to their own lack of knowledge and misunderstandings, they will spread the fitna. And today we are seeing that this is happening in the world. وَعَنِ الْأَحْوَسِ بْنِ حَكِيمٍ عَنْ عَبِيهِ قَالَ سَأَلَ رَجُلُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَنِ الشَّرِّ فَقَالَ لَا تَسْأَلُونِي عَنِ الشَّرِّ وَسَلُونِي عَنِ الْخَيْرِ يَقُولُهَا ثَلَاثًا ثُمَّ قَالَ أَلَا إِنَّ شَرَّ الشَّرِّ شِرَارُ الْعُلَمَاءِ وَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الْخَيْرِ خِيَارُ الْعُلَمَاءِ رواه الدارمي. Hazrat Ahwas bin Hakim reports, and he takes this narration from his father, that our beloved Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said. Actually, his father says that somebody asked a question from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about shar, about an evil. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Do not ask me about evil. Rather ask me about goodness." And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that 3 times. And then he said, "Be aware that worst of all evils are the bad ulama, ulama su, and best of the best are the good ulama, those ulama who fear Almighty Allah Azza wa Jal." Ahwas bin Hakim is a tabi'i, and he met Hazrat Anas and Hazrat Abdullah ibn Yasr radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. His father is Hakim ibn Umar, and he is Sahabi. So this question was about shar, what it means. It means that this person wanted to know about sin and what are the reasons why the sin is committed and what are the ways and methods to refrain from it. And it is a good thing to know about sins, and it is good thing to know about the good deeds, the virtuous deeds. Keep in mind that one should know about good deeds to practice upon the good deeds, and one should know about the sins to refrain from the sins. Therefore, ulama ikram have said that it is fard, it is obligatory upon Muslims to know the words of blasphemy, so you can refrain from it. Alhamdulillah Azza wa Jal, Amir Ahle Sunnat Damat Barakatuhum Al-Qudsiyah has helped us in this field by writing beautiful, wonderful, detailed book on this topic known and called Kufriya Kalimat Ke Bare Mein Sawal Jawab, Questions and Answers Regarding Words of Blasphemy. That is a wonderful book, and this is fard, mean obligatory, upon every Muslim to know those words so we can refrain from using those words, safeguard our iman and protect our iman. So this person asked about shar, about sin. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam guided him and gave him a direction that don't always ask about bad things. Sometimes ask about good things as well. And then towards the end of hadith, it is mentioned that worst of worst, or bad of all the bads, are those ulama who are evil, who are ulama su. And the best of the best are those who fear Allah Azza wa Jal, and they are good ulama. When an alim is crooked, whole nation becomes crooked. When an alim tries and puts an effort to look after the nation, worry about their condition and try to uplift them, then the nation is uplifted. Alim-e-Deen is a captain of the ship of Muslims. So if that ship sinks, everyone who is sitting in that ship will sink as well. And if that ship reaches its destination, then everyone will reach at their destinations as well. So therefore, it is very important that your ulama, who are your religious leaders, they are upright and they are practical, they are sincere, and they follow and practice the sunnah of the beloved Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they are true representative of beloved master sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now there are so many sects and problems in Muslim society. All that is due to the kindness of evil ulama, ulama su. But this does not mean the true color of Islam will vanish. The ulama haq will remain and they will stay in the society, and the barakat of knowledge will continue, and the truth of Islam will not disappear. Wa an Ziyad ibn Hudayr qala li Umar هل تعرف ما يهدم الإسلام؟ قلت لا. قال يهدمه ذلة العالم وجدال المنافق بالكتاب وحكم الأئمة المدلين. رواه الدارمي. This hadith is reported by Hazrat Ziyad ibn Hudayr. He says, that Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu asked me, do you know what demolishes Islam? I said, no. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu said that a mistake of an alim and arguing of a hypocrite in matters of Quran and rules of misguided chiefs demolishes or destroys Islam. This hadith is from Hazrat Ziyad ibn Hudayr. His kuniyat is Abu Mughira. He belongs to Qabila Bani Asad, tribe Bani Asad. He's Kufi, mean lived in Kufa. He's a Tabi'i. He took a hadith from Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Now in this a question was asked. Do you know what demolishes Islam? What it means? It means, what is that action which will take the respect of Islam away from the hearts of Muslims? Or the awesomeness of Islam will be taken away from the hearts of the Muslims? What is that? So, he said, no, I don't know. So Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala told him, when alim makes mistake, what is the meaning of alim making mistake? It means that when alim is looking for comforts, when he becomes lazy and they got no time in doing research in the matters of Sharia, because research takes time, it is hard work, you have to spend hours and hours of reading. So because of their laziness, they don't do that. And they tell wrong masalas, they give wrong conclusions and solutions to people for their problems. And that is happening very often. Or they come up in the form of corrupted scholars who have corrupt beliefs. Their beliefs are not corresponding with the mainstream Islam. So that way they will invent many innovations, especially in the matters of aqaid. They will bring new things in the deen, that mean in the aqidah. They will change the fundamental issues of aqidah. And they will do the interpretations of Quran with their own opinion. And then the other thing is mentioned, when a munafiq, when a hypocrite, he starts fighting in Quran, means he discusses Quran and he causes fitna amongst Muslims by quoting Quran, by giving wrong interpretations of Quran Kareem. And at the last, it is mentioned that the misleaded people, mudilleen, misguided ones, they will become rulers. They will become hakim. And they will force other people to follow them. Then the power of Islam will be weak, and the awesomeness of Islam, the ru'ub of Islam, will be out of the hearts of people. And we see that is happening. And because of these type of activities and these type of people, there's no much respect left for the Muslims. Alhamdulillah, Islam is the true religion. Islam will stay, and Islam is going to be there always. But respect as a nation is no more there. And it is also said that this lagzish or mistake of an alim means that he will get involved in fisq and fujur, in sins, or they'll become rebellious, open sinners. Because amal of an alim, practice of an alim, is tabligh, is a propagation on its own. If an alim-e-deen is a hard-working worshipper as well, if he performs his nawafil, his sunan, he eats according to sunnah, he drinks according to sunnah, he sits, he stands, he does everything, he establishes the sunnah of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is preaching the true Islam and the real Islam. But if he is a sinner, then he will misguide the community. Even if he commits small sins, by looking at him, the people, his followers, will start committing bigger sins and major sins. An Abi Hurairata qala hafiztu min Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wi'a'ayni fa amma ahaduhuma fabathastuhu fikum wa ammal akharu falau basastuhu kuti'a hadhal bul'umu ya'ni majra ta'ami rawahul Bukhari. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala reports, he says actually that I protected two pots of knowledge from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One I distributed amongst you, and the other one is that if I spread that pot of knowledge amongst you, this would be cut off, means the throat would be cut off. It means that I have received two types of knowledge from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One is the ilm of Sharia, which I have told you already, and the other one is the knowledge of asrar, the secrets of Almighty Allah Azza wa Jal, and tariqat and haqiqat. And if I show that, people will not understand my words and they will think that I have left the deen and I'm saying things which are contrary to the deen, and they will kill me. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu sometimes used to talk things with ishara, with kinaya, with indications, and let people think about it and let people guess about it. He used to say that, in fact, he used to make dua that, oh Allah Azza wa Jal, save me, protect me, give me refuge from the time of fitnas, when young boys will rule. And he used to say, even mention the year, he would say the 60 Hijri, save me from the mischiefs of 60 Hijri, when there will be fitnas and young boys would be ruling. And actually, in the 60 Hijra, Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala passed away, and then Yazid Palid became the ruler. So his dua indicates towards two things. One was the passing away of Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and the second was Yazid taking over the government. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his dua, that 1 year before the departure of Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu from this dunya, Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu passed away. From this hadith mubarakah, we learn few beautiful masail. Number one, that one should express the masail of Sharia without any hesitation. But the secrets of tasawwuf and Sufism and haqiqat and tariqat should not be told to incapable people. And unfortunately, these days, there are many who claim to be so-called Sufis, who are uneducated, who are not ulama. They read one or two or few books, and they think they are scholars in that branch of knowledge, and they discuss matters of tasawwuf in front of ordinary people. And in fact, some of them will tell even members of their club or people who belong to their particular circle that these are secrets, don't discuss with anyone, just keep it to yourself. And they fill the fire of hatred in the hearts of their followers against ulama ikram. So most of these people, they are far away from ulama ikram. They don't listen to the bayans of ulama ikram. They don't listen to the correct and authentic tafaseer and the interpretations of Quran Kareem and the interpretations of Ahadith Mubarakah. So they are caught up in this big trick of shaitan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard them and take them out of this difficulty or test in which they are caught up. And we can also understand that it could mean that one should not express or tell unnecessary things to the people which would cause fitna. So this masala is also learnt from this hadith mubarakah. And also we learn that our beloved Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is blessed with ilm-e ghaib, with the knowledge of unseen. Since his companions, his slaves, sahaba ikram, they knew so much knowledge. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he learned that knowledge from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If that is the vastness of his knowledge, then what would be the vastness of the knowledge of Khulafa'i Rashideen? And then what would be the vastness of the knowledge of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Nobody can measure that, and nobody can assess and understand that. Wa an Abdullah qala ya yuhannas man alima shay'an falyaqul bihi wa man lam ya'lam falyaqul Allahu a'lamu fa inna min al-'ilmi an taqula lima la ta'lamu Allahu a'lamu. This hadith is from Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and this Abdullah is Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. O people, if you know something, express it. And anyone of you who don't know something, you must say, Allahu alamu, Allah knows best. Because this is knowledge. If you don't know something, you should say, Allah knows best. So this is a sign of knowledge. If you're blessed with knowledge, when you don't know something, you say, Allahu alamu, Allah knows best. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said to his beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قُلْ مَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَجْرٍ وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُتَكَلِّفِينَ. That, O beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them that I don't ask any reward from you for the nabuwat or the favors that I have done upon you. And I'm not from pretenders, those who pretend. This hadith mubarakah is reported from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And what is the meaning of this hadith mubarakah? When an alim makes a mistake, he should not feel shy to tell his mistake, to express his mistake. And when he doesn't know any masala, he should not fabricate a masala. Because our not knowing is bigger than our knowing, or our ignorance is bigger than our knowledge. So there will be times when we don't know. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran Kareem, وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. You are not given but little knowledge. So the one who has little knowledge will make mistakes and will forget, would not know things at times. And the best thing is, Allahu A'lamu, I don't know. Angels said in the court of Allah Azza wa Jal, La ilma lana, we don't have the knowledge. So that if the angels can say La ilma lana, we don't have the knowledge, then we can also say La a'lamu, La adri, Allah knows best. As Sayyidina Ali al-Murtaza Shere Khuda radiallahu ta'ala anhu was standing on pulpit and somebody stood up and he asked a masala and he said, I don't know. So there was a person sitting there who insulted Hazrat Ali al-Murtaza Shere Khuda radiallahu ta'ala and he said that if you don't know the masala, why are you sitting on the pulpit on the member? He radiallahu ta'ala replied, I have climbed on the member according to the level of my knowledge. Had I climbed on the member according to my ignorance, then I would not have been sitting on the member. I would not have been sitting on the pulpit, but I would have been sitting on the sky then. So, dearest Islamic brothers and the viewers of Madani channel, from here we learn that we should always be humble and we should always be honest. And when we don't know something, we must say, I don't know. When somebody asked Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, what is the difference between fruit and grass? He said, I don't know. Hazrat Imam Malik, a great muhaddith, a great jurist, who is a founder of Madhab Maliki, he could not answer 36 questions. And he said, when those questions were asked from him, he said, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. And once somebody asked Hazrat Imam Azam Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala, what is the meaning of dahar? He said, I don't know. La alamu, la adri. And alhamdulillah, we see that Amir Ahle Sunnat Damat Barakatuhum Al-Qudsiyah has established this practice and has encouraged ulama that don't feel shy to say, La alamu, la adri, I don't know. Because this is knowledge. An ignorant person will never say, I don't know. Because he does not have the taste or the sweetness of knowledge. And a person who is knowledgeable, he will never be shy to say, I don't know, or only Allah knows. We make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to practice upon the beautiful sunnahs of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which are taught very much in the mahal, in the environment of Dawat Islami. So stay in touch. Wherever in the world you are, alhamdulillah, Dawat Islami is there everywhere. You will find some links and stay in touch, attend weekly Madani ijtimaas and travel in Madani kafilas, fill Madani in'amat cards, inshallah azza wa jal, you will see a great change and revolution within yourself. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us practical Muslims and give us knowledge and make us practical ulama. Ameen bijahin nabiyil ameen sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sallu ala al-habib sallallahu ta'ala ala Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Salatun wa salaman alayka ya sayyidi ya rasulallah wa ala alika wa ashabika ya habiballah.
You who's here
hidden away from